All right, thank you everyone for coming to this presentation today. Thank you to the previous speakers for the very insightful papers. I'm going to talk about a paper that's hard to classify as a theory building paper and hard to classify as a theory testing paper, so it wouldn't get into the Academic Management Review or the Academic Management Journal. But I think it's an important paper in the sense that it introduces a new concept and sort of tries to begin the exploration of learning about that concept. So, as entrepreneurship scholars and educators, we think and talk about technology all the time. Because entrepreneurs change technology, and their products use and build on technology. So we talk about this all the time. In our classes, we show examples of the latest technology that entrepreneurs have introduced. Drones, smart watches, smart Internet of Things objects like Barbara was talking about in her presentation, software like Snapchat and Uber that have changed the world, all these technologies. Actually, as an entrepreneurship educator, raise your hand if you've talked about one of these examples at least in your class. Oh, many of you have. Right, so we talk about technology, how entrepreneurs change technology, how they use it in their products all the time. What we don't talk about is how technology changes entrepreneurship and how the process of entrepreneurship itself uses and builds on technology. We don't talk about this much. And the way to really understand that we don't talk about it is think of these phrases that I'm going to use. We talk about technology entrepreneurship. In fact, we have entire articles, books on technology entrepreneurship. But nobody talks about entrepreneurship technology. It's not a phrase that's used in our vocabulary talking about entrepreneurship. It's like it's a distant concept to us. Even though in business schools we have, typically we have an information systems department, a business technology department, we rarely actually focus on how technology is applied to entrepreneurship. Now, how did I stumble on this topic? I actually made a list of resources for my own entrepreneurship students that were basically a lot of technological tools. I made this list and I sort of wanted to use it just as a teaching tool, a list of resources for my students. So I published it on the internet. You can find it at entrepreneurtools.zeef.com. Zeef is a Dutch company, I believe, that creates a platform for online lists, so I used their platform. Then after a few days, I was sleeping one day, I woke up, I realized somebody has posted this list on Product Hunt, and it's got more than 1,000 votes by now, and people all around the world are sharing it, tweeting about it in different languages. Actually, these are a collection of the tweets just from the first few days. And I realized, wow, people are really interested in this stuff. Even though there were lots of lists similar to my list before, but mine was just a more updated one compared to some of the existing lists that were out there. So people were really interested. They were calling it one of the most comprehensive lists of resources for entrepreneurs. They really liked it. And I thought, wow, entrepreneurs are hungry about this, about learning what are the latest tools and technologies that support their work. How can technology make their life easier as an entrepreneur? So I thought, let's define this as a research agenda, as a topic for to study, and not just study, to teach as well. I'm going to be teaching the world's first course on entrepreneurship technology at the University of Calgary starting winter 2018. Teaching a course is, of course, a way to force yourself to really learn about it yourself. So that's what I'm going to do. So this is an initial exploration. I thought, okay, if we're going to make it a topic of teaching, a topic of research, we need to define it. How do we define it? This is what I've come up with. The application of technological tools to support the process of starting and running a new venture. Typically, these tools are IT-enabled and web-based systems, so you rarely have a tool for entrepreneurship that's a physical product. Typically, these are software, and typically they're web-based. And they can apply to various stages of an entrepreneurial firm's life cycle. I have a bunch of examples in the paper. For example, ideation, there's a whole bunch of tools for brainstorming, coming up with ideas, linking different ideas together, sharing ideas, ranking ideas among the team. There are now a bunch of tools and resources for finding co-founders, founder dating, foundersnation.com, and these are rapidly evolving ecosystems, right? So a lot of these tools didn't exist 5 years ago. And actually, from the time that I've written these to now, probably some of them are no longer in service because it's a fast evolving landscape. Some of these tools come and go. Some of them are experiments and they realize that it's not a valid business model. Pitching, there's now a bunch of tools out there. Actually, there's only one tool that I found that really helps practice your pitch, pitcherific.com. But there are other tools to help sort of document the pitch, send it to investors, distribute it, and then track its usage. Logo design, there's actually, even though you can go on fiverr.com and pay $5 for logo design, the cost has come so low now that you can go on many websites now and actually have artificial intelligence help you design a logo for almost free prices. Accounting and invoicing, of course, I won't go through it all. Some of the most impressive tools that are out there for entrepreneurs that I think are becoming critical to entrepreneurial ventures. Wave, for example, is an accounting tool. It's actually based in Toronto. I talked to the founder of it. He's one of the co-founders of Wave. He's trying to, he's part of the group trying to start a good entrepreneurial ecosystem in Calgary, Rainforest, Alberta, they're calling it. But he was telling me that I don't know why in your business school you're teaching accounting, because companies like Wave are going to disrupt accounting altogether. It's going to be almost automated for entrepreneurs. They don't need to worry about accounting or hire expensive accountants anymore. Tools like Buffer and Hootsuite are now helping entrepreneurs manage social media and automate a lot of their social media posting. A lot of tools for launching a quick landing page to get feedback, to get sign-ups for a mailing list. And actually, Unbounce and Optimizely help you do A/B testing directly on the landing page as well. So a lot of advanced stuff that used to take advanced computer programmers lots of money to do can now be done with just a few dollars a month, which is typically the pricing model of most of these. MailChimp has a very entrepreneur-friendly pricing model. A lot of these do. MailChimp, for example, grow with the startup's mailing list numbers. So if you have low numbers, you're a very sort of young startup, they charge nothing. It's free. And then they grow with you as a business. There are now tools like user testing, Validately, that help entrepreneurs actually go out and test their ideas with real users. Zapier, the automation category of software, is making huge, hugely important changes in entrepreneurship. Zapier is all about standards. It uses APIs to connect to different pieces of software, and then it automates the interaction of those software. I actually use the combination of Zapier and something that's out there called Airtable to automatically send my students each other's assignments for them to peer review. It was very easy to set up Zapier, Airtable, and Gmail. So these three tools connected together created an automated system for peer review, and I didn't have to pay a software programmer to do it. And entrepreneurs are doing this sort of thing all the time. So with this type of software, the cost of entrepreneurship is coming down immensely. This is a famous graph that's shared on the internet by Mark Schuster at Upfront Ventures, a venture capital firm, that sort of shows how the cost of starting a web startup is reducing fast. And I think entrepreneurship technology is making this happen. Of course, there's a bunch of drivers. I think, for example, open source and free software is one of the big drivers. Cloud computing, the availability of Amazon Web Services is one of the big drivers. Just the economics of digital products, that these tools come out because they're digital products, they have zero marginal cost, so there's usually cutthroat competition, prices are reduced quickly, so entrepreneurs benefit from these reduced prices. And then because it's easy to build these and there's lots of entrepreneurs coming in, then there's more and more of these tools being built. So now they're called a category of startups for startups that's recognized by founder of Y Combinator, for example, in the 2008 memo as an attractive investment category. So computer-mediated transactions, the fact that the internet has allowed a lot of interesting transactions, has allowed a lot of automation, and not just automation, but also human-to-human contracting has been made much more efficient by technology, and this has given rise to a lot of these entrepreneurship technologies. Why have we missed it in business school so far? First, I think because a lot of IS research has been focused on established organizations, the phenomenon of these startups for startups is actually pretty new. In 2008, the term startups were sort of coined. And entrepreneurship itself is a pretty new field of study. So I think these are three main reasons why we have missed it at business school so far. But it's important. Y Combinator, for example, as a top incubator, is teaching its cohort of startups what are the best technologies to use and training them in how to use it. DataNize is one of the companies that catalogs these tools by going through the codes of their websites and sort of checking what tools they use. I don't think that's the best method to figure out all the tools because not all of them show in the website's code. But this is one method, and DataNize has good data on that. Startup Stash is my tool had more than 1,000 votes on Product Hunt, but Startup Stash is, I think, the most upvoted tool on Product Hunt, more than 7,000 votes. And there are many different directories like this that sort of go through all the catalog, all the different tools for startups. Yeah, almost 8,000 upvotes for it. So what we did in this paper, me and Miles Johnson, our PhD student at Haskane, we sort of went through all of these directories, Startup Stash, Siftery, Entrepreneur Tools, a bunch of these directories, and we created an analysis of how they're sort of terming their categories to sort of understand the breadth of entrepreneurship technology. So management, analytics, security, design, marketing, these are various factors that sort of are being automated by these technologies or supported. Interesting findings from studying this breadth. A lot of them use different words for similar concepts like mockups versus prototyping. There's always a miscellaneous or other category in these directories, which shows that it's a fast-evolving landscape. It's really hard to categorize. Some of the tools are directed at developers or specialists like designers, but what's really interesting is the ones that don't really require any specialist knowledge, and the entrepreneur can do it themselves, even if they're not a specialist. The pervasiveness of the lean startup approach can be seen in a lot of these tools. They use the terminology of testing, the terminology of feedback, customer development, and that shows, it is another indicator, I think, that the research world is far behind practice because we don't have much of the research out there on the lean startup method, just like we don't on entrepreneurship technology. So there are interesting things about thinking of entrepreneurship technology as a distinct concept in terms of how do you distinguish it from regular enterprise technology. It's difficult to do because there are overlaps. There are some tools that are used by entrepreneurs and enterprises. There are some tools that are actually made for entrepreneurs first, like crowdfunding, but are now being used by enterprises as well. And there are some tools that were made for enterprises, but are now, they're customized versions of that are being created for entrepreneurs, like customer relationship management packages. So basically, I've tried to think of four criteria for what to include in the scope of entrepreneurship technology if we're going to define it as an area for research and teaching.
1 minute.
Criteria one, the tool's functionality specifically addresses a task or need that is an important part of the entrepreneurial process. Pitching, finding gold, founder, raising capital. The main things entrepreneurs need to do, if the tool's functionality addresses those, we can call it entrepreneurship technology. These are suggestions. Two, the tools provider specifically markets it to entrepreneurs. So it could be CRM, but CRM, lightweight, cheaper, good pricing model for entrepreneurs. Even if it's not explicitly marketed to entrepreneurs, it may, among other tools with similar functionality, have certain functionality that's specifically good for entrepreneurs. For example, I don't think Trello, the sort of task management software, actually meant it initially to be for entrepreneurs. They meant it as a team collaboration sort of software. But it turned out that between other team collaboration softwares, Trello was particularly good for entrepreneurs in the way that its features were designed. And so now it's very, very popular among entrepreneurs. And finally, I think pragmatically speaking, just like what words are actual words in a language as recognized as legitimate words, I think pragmatically, whatever is widely used by entrepreneurs, we should recognize as entrepreneurship technology. So my final thought is that teaching students entrepreneurship without teaching them entrepreneurship technology will be increasingly like teaching accounting and finance without teaching them how to use spreadsheets or even a calculator. So I think in business schools, we really need to start catching up on the latest tools that actual entrepreneurs are using, or we face the threat of becoming increasingly irrelevant to the actual world of entrepreneurship. So I'm going to be starting a course in the University of Calgary as of winter 2018. It's really hard to setting good standards for teaching there because there are such great teachers like Houston and Roslyn back there at the University of Calgary's Haskins School of Business. I thank you for listening, and I welcome any comments or questions.
Thank you.